One of the emergency responders who was on the ground, Mr. Brian Farinloe of the National Emergency Management Agency, he was also there. He gave his account at the time, but let's get him back now. He's on the phone today to speak to us on his experience on that first day. Morning, and thank you for joining us today on the program. We've got Mr. Ken Emeka of the Synagogue Church here, who says nobody could have prevented, he's not sure if that account is true. What happened when you went there the first day that this building collapsed?
Well, good morning, viewers and listeners. Well, it's quite an unfortunate incident that happened at the church. When we got there, being a humanitarian agency, we were initially prevented to even pass the gate. It took us close to 20 minutes with struggling here and there before we had access there.
Who prevented
when
you?
We were confined to a particular cell under the rubbles, very close to the incident scene. From that place, somebody alerted us, two people are hiding somewhere. That we were prevented actually from carrying out our activities.
By who?
We were prevented by the church members.
Who are the church members? Did you identify anybody as a church member? And what time did you get there?
Just a minute.
Are the people, what we got, initially we even thought they were proud of the color boys that were doing the work. But later we got to know that they were all church members. Because some of them, the information from them didn't indicate they were Nigerians. So when we found this group out, we now thought, the responders now said, these are not Nigerians. We should be very, very careful in handling the situation so that their national academy, the embassy, do not put it up. In case we take hardline approach to them. So the next thing I did, I had so many people. There is a lady I continue to ask, where is your local advisor? So that if I get your local advisor, your legal advisor will do rebuttal to people to know the implication of preventing rescuers from getting to the scene. Throughout the whole operation, we didn't see any senior officer that turned up, especially the legal advisor, because for the first 3 days, I continually called for the legal advisor's attention to come over, but nobody serves as a leader in the court. That was the first. The second day, we were reluctant to, we had to leave that scene late in the evening because of the hostility and harassment we measured out to us. We had to leave so that we will not be digitally attacked when the night falls because we won't be able to know, pinpoint anybody. That was the first time many of us were going to that compound. So we didn't know anybody. The policemen, but we don't know this. They said that when I called the command, Lagos State Police Command, they said to go to touch with the DPO. We got the DPO. When I was trying to explain the frustration we were having with the DPO, somehow we just moved out. But later when I saw, I said, I'm talking to you, we just talked out of it. I didn't know the pressure it was under. Maybe he was going out to do something. That was why he left me. I said that you worked, that you should have even excused me. Then I now threatened to call the press headquarters. Then somebody now came up again from, I think, I don't know whether it's ACP or so. The ACP was trying to settle down. The church member was shouting up another thing. Then we all decided that the situation cannot be under the control of police or anybody when the night falls. That was why we moved that night around 6:45 p.m. The following morning, we were reluctant to move in. Lasema DM was there early in the morning, was manhandled. It was later, the man of God, that's Pastor T.B. Gopra, intervened. When he intervened, they were not so much outside, but on the scene, they didn't give us room. Until Sunday afternoon, around 12:01, maybe that was when they heard that the governor was to visit, we will now have direct access to the victim. Working directly. And the governor now came up around 5 o'clock before he ordered evacuation of everybody. However, when he ordered the evacuation, we said we still need the services of the church members to take them
All right.
On the something. That was what happened.
All right. Thank you, Brian Fariloyi, the public relations officer at NEMA in Southwest Nigeria. Well, you've heard his account there.
Well, clearly you could see the contradictions there.
He
confirmed that when they got there, that they saw a crowd. Because like I said, we are talking of a place that was, it was on a street. We have a major street there, and we have canteens, two canteens that serve members of the public. So if people could, if the crowd could access the place, and he was talking about, he was particular, he wanted to see the legal advisor or whatever. That is not the issue. The issue is, did any member of the church deprive them access or deny them access to the place?
So that's what you would have impossible. Why did the general overseer then have to intervene in that matter?
You see, if you,
if the church members were
intervening, how? That was what you had. That was his statement. How did he intervene? The day in question, every other person, including Prophet T.B. Joshua himself, was busy trying to see how he could be of any help.
At least we have on tape the governor of Lagos State asking the prophet to please tell church members to vacate so that, you know, the emergency workers can do their work. We have that on tape at least.
That does not in any way amount to preventing or denying them access to the place. Church members are human beings. Church members are human beings who saw their members, their colleagues, were victims. Okay? Why not look at it from the point that these human beings may be trying, though ignorantly, they may be trying to making their own efforts, whatever they think they could do to help.
To the point that they will not allow agencies to help?
No. You see, what the response agencies may be demanding from them could be captured from the request from the Lagos State Governor, when he said, we need church members to clear this, to leave the place. That means the response agencies may have wanted these people to just leave
and
allow us to do our job, which is still okay.
What interest?
But you don't expect people who they are agitated.
What interest do you think that NEMA and LASEMA has or will have? What interest do you think they will have, or what would they profit if they tell lies against the church?
Well, you see, I haven't said they told lies against the church, but you never can tell which
interest. You have said so. You have said it's not true.
Yes, now.
If something is not true, it's a lie.
Because his own statement, it is clear that nobody stopped them or denied them access to the place. It's a different thing that, okay, for instance, that there could be an accident on the road now. Sympathizers, passers-by could throng the place.
I'm sure they know.
Making efforts.
They know the difference between, this is not their first job, they know the difference between sympathizers and people who are preventing them from getting access to the place.
If I am not trained now to do the rescue job, but I am here and something happened here, I might be making my own honest and genuine effort
to
help.
Do you also want to make a quick clarification on this story that's making the rounds? You don't know how it's true about the 50,000 naira bribe. Is that true?
To who?
To journalists. Did you hear of that story at all?
This is the first time I'm hearing.
Making
who?
The story online.
By who?
It's making the rounds by a journalist.
Who tried to bribe the
That journal? You had called a press conference. There had been the church had called a press conference, and when journalists were about to leave, 50,000 naira was distributed, and they were asked to report what the church says they should report.
Well, if you know this church, first of all, do not forget that this church, we also own our own media house. Okay, Emmanuel TV is a media house also. So this church will never and can never get involved in such a thing. And I challenge any journalist that say that to come out. We are prepared to go the full hog of investigation to identify who tried to do that.